Maruja. By Bret Hart. Podcast 4 of 5. Chapter 8. When Faquita had made sure that her young mistress was so securely closeted with Dona Maria that morning as to be inaccessible to curious eyes and ears, she saw fit to bewail to her fellow servants this further evidence of the decay of the old feudal and patriarchal mutual family confidences. Time was, thou rememberest, Pepita, when an affair of this kind was openly discussed at chocolate with everybody present, and before us all. When Joaquin Padilla was shot at Monterey, it was the Dona herself who told us, who read aloud the letters describing it and the bullet holes in his clothes, and made it quite a gala day, and he was a first cousin of Gutierrez. And now, when this American goat of a doctor is kicked to death by a mule, the family must shut themselves up, that never a question is asked or answered. I, responded Pepita, and as regards that, Sanchez there knows as much as they do, for it was he that almost saw the whole affair. How, sawest it? Inquired Faquita, eagerly. Why, was it not he that was bringing home Perillo, who had been lying in one of his trances or visions, blessed St. Antonio preserve us, said Pepita, hastily crossing herself on Coratora's grave, when the doctor's mustang charged down upon them like a wild bull, and the doctor's foot half out of the stirrups, and he not yet fast in his seat. And Perillo laughs a wild laugh and says, watch if the coyote does not drag yet at his mustang's heels, and Sanchez ran and watched the doctor out of sight, careering and galloping to his death, as Perillo prophesied. For it was only half an hour afterward that Sanchez again heard the tramp of his hoofs as if it were here, and knowing it 2 miles away, thou understandest, he said to himself, it is over. The two women shuddered and crossed themselves. And what says Perillo of the fulfillment of his prophecy? Asked Faquita, hugging herself in her shawl with a certain titillating shrug of fascinating horror. It is even possible he understands it not. Thou knowest how dazed and dumb he ever is after these visions, that he comes from them as one from the grave, remembering nothing. He has lain like a log all the morning. Aye, but this news should awaken him, if aught can. He loved not this sneaking doctor. Let us seek him, mayhap, Sanchez may be there. Come. The mistress lacks us not just now, the guests are provided for. Come. She led the way to the eastern angle of the casa, communicating by a low corridor with the corral and stables. This was the old gatekeep or quarters of the mayordomo, who, among his functions, was supposed to exercise a supervision over the exits and entrances of the house. A large steward's room or office, beyond it a room of general assembly, half guard room, half servants' hall, and Perillo's sleeping room, constituted his domain. A few peons were gathered in the hall near the open door of the apartment where Perillo lay. Stretched on a low pallet, his face yellow as wax, a light burning under a crucifix near his head, and a spray of blessed palm, popularly supposed to avert the attempts of evil spirits to gain possession of his suspended faculties, Perillo looked not unlike a corpse. Two muffled and shawled domestics, who sat by his side, might have been mourners, but for their voluble and incessant chattering. So thou art here, Faquita, said a stout virago. It is a wonder thou couldst spare time from prayers for the repose of the American doctor's soul to look after the health of thy superior, poor Perillo. Is it, then, true that Dona Maria said she would have naught more to do with the drunken brute of her mayordomo? The awful fascination of Perillo's upturned face did not prevent Faquita from tossing her head as she replied, pertly, that she was not there to defend her mistress from lazy gossip. Nay, but what said she? Asked the other attendant. She said Perillo was to want for nothing, but at present she could not see him. A murmur of indignation and sympathy passed through the company. It was followed by a long sigh from the insensible man. His lips move, said Faquita, still fascinated by curiosity. Hush, he would speak. His lips move, but his soul is still asleep, said Sanchez, oracularly. Thus they have moved since early morning, when I came to speak with him, and found him lying here in a fit upon the floor. He was half dressed, thou seest, as if he had risen to go forth, and had been struck down so. Hush! I tell thee he speaks, said Faquita. The sick man was faintly articulating through a few tiny bubbles that broke upon his rigid lips. He dared me. He said I was old, too old. Who dared thee? Who said thou wast too old, asked the eager Faquita, bending over him. He, Corotera himself, in the shape of a coyote. Faquita fell back with a little giggle, half of shame, half of awe. It is ever thus, said Sanchez, sententiously, it is what he said last night, when I picked him up on the mound. He will sleep now, thou shalt see. He will get no further than Corotera and the coyote, and then he will sleep. And to the awe of the group, and the increased respect for Sanchez's wisdom, Perillo seemed to fall again into a lethargic slumber. It was late in the evening when he appeared to regain perfect consciousness. Ah, what is this? He said, roughly, sitting up in bed, and eyeing the watchers around him, some of whom had succumbed to sleep, and others were engaged in playing cards. Caramba, are ye mad? Thou, Sanchez, here, who shouldst be at thy work in the stables. Thou, Pepita, is thy mistress asleep or dead, that thou sittest here? Blessed San Antonio! Would ye drive me mad? He lifted his hand to his head, with a dull movement of pain, and attempted to rise from the bed. Softly, good Perillo, lie still, said Sanchez, approaching him. Thou hast been ill, so ill. These, thy friends, have been waiting only for this moment to be assured that thou art better. For this idleness there is no blame, truly none. The Dona Maria has said that thou shouldst lack no care, and, truly, since the terrible news there has been little to do. The terrible news, repeated Perillo. Sanchez cast a meaning glance upon the others, as if to indicate this co-affirmation of his diagnosis. Aye, terrible news. The Dr. West was found this morning dead 2 miles from the casa. Dr. West dead, repeated Perillo, slowly, as if endeavoring to master the real meaning of the words. Then, seeing the vacuity of his question reflected on the faces of those around him, he added, hurriedly, with a feeble smile, oh, I did. Yes. I remember. And he has been ill, very ill, eh? It was an accident. He was thrown from his horse, and so killed, returned Sanchez, gravely. Killed by his horse, sayest thou, said Perillo, with a sudden fixed look in his eye. Aye, good Perillo. Dost thou not remember when the Mustang bolted with him down upon us in the lane, and then thou didst say he would come to evil with the brute? He did, bless San Antonio, within half an hour. How thou sawest it? Nay, for the Mustang was running away and I did not follow. Bueno. It happened all the same. The alcalde, coroner, who knows all about it, has said so an hour ago. Juan brought the news from the rancho where the inquest was. There will be a funeral the day after tomorrow. And so it is that some of the family will go. Fancy, Perillo, a Gutierrez at the funeral of the Americano doctor. Nay, I doubt not that the Dona Maria will ask thee to say a prayer over his bier. Peace, fool, and speak not of thy lady mistress, thundered the old man, sitting upright. Begone to the stables. Dost thou hear me? Go. Now, by the mother of miracles, said Sanchez, hastening from the room as the gaunt figure of the old man rose, like a sheeted specter, from the bed, that was his old self again. Bless San Antonio. Perillo has recovered. The next day he was at his usual duties, with perhaps a slight increase of sternness in his manner. The fulfillment of his prophecy related by Sanchez added to the superstitious reputation in which he was held, although Faquita voiced the opinions of a growing skeptical party in the statement that it was easy to prophesy the doctor's accident, with the spectacle of the horse actually running away before the prophet's eyes. It was even said that Dona Maria's aversion to Perillo since the accident arose from a belief that some assistance might have been rendered by him. But it was pointed out by Sanchez that Perillo had, a few moments before, fallen under one of those singular, epileptic-like strokes to which he was subject, and not only was unfit, but even required the entire care of Sanchez at the time. He did not attend the funeral, nor did Mrs. Saltonstall, but the family was represented by Maruja and Umita, accompanied by one or two dark-faced cousins, Captain Carroll and Raymond. A number of friends and business associates from the neighboring towns, Aladdin, and a party from his house, the farm laborers, and a crowd of working men from his mills in the foothills, swelled the assemblage that met in and around the rude agricultural sheds and outhouses which formed the only pastoral habitation of the Rancho of San Antonio. It had been a characteristic injunction of the deceased that he should be buried in the midst of one of his most prolific grain fields, as a grim return to that nature he was impoverishing, with neither mark nor monument to indicate the spot, and that even the temporary mound above him should, at the fitting season of the year, be leveled with the rest of the field by the obliterating plowshares. A grave was accordingly dug about a quarter of a mile from his office amidst a volunteer crop so dense that the large space mown around the narrow opening, to admit of the presence of the multitude, seemed like a golden amphitheater. A distinguished clergyman from San Francisco officiated. A man of tact and politic adaptation, he dwelt upon the blameless life of the deceased, on his practical benefit for civilization in the county, and even treated his grim pantheism in the selection of his grave as a formal recognition of the text, dust to dust. He paid a not ungrateful compliment to the business associates of the deceased, and, without actually claiming in the usual terms a continuance of past favors for their successors, managed to interpolate so strong a recommendation of the late doctor's commercial projects as to elicit from Aladdin the expressive commendation that his sermon was as good as 5% in the stock. Maruja, who had been standing near the carriage, languidly silent and abstracted even under the tender attentions of Carol, suddenly felt the consciousness of another pair of eyes fixed upon her. Looking up, she was surprised to find herself regarded by the man she had twice met, once as a tramp and once as a wayfarer at the fonda, who had quietly joined a group not far from her. At once impressed by the idea that this was the first time that he had really looked at her, she felt a singular shyness creeping over her, until, to her own astonishment and indignation, she was obliged to lower her eyes before his gaze. In vain she tried to lift them, with her old supreme power of fascination. If she had ever blushed, she felt she would have done so now. She knew that her face must betray her consciousness, and at last she Maruja, the self-poised and all-sufficient goddess actually turned, in half-hysterical and girlish bashfulness, to Carol for relief in an affected and exaggerated absorption of his attentions. She scarcely knew that the clergyman had finished speaking, when Raymond approached them softly from behind. "Pray don't believe," he said, appealingly, "that all the human virtues are about to be buried, I should say sown in that wheatfield. A few will still survive, and creep about above the doctor's grave. Listen to a story just told me, and disbelieve if you dare in human gratitude. Do you see that picturesque young ruffian over there?" Maruja did not lift her eyes. She felt herself breathlessly hanging on the speaker's next words. "Why, that's the young man of the fonda, who picked up your fan," said Carol, "isn't it?" "Perhaps," said Maruja, indifferently. She would have given worlds to have been able to turn coldly and stare at him at that moment with the others, but she dared not. She contented herself with softly brushing some dust from Captain Carroll's arm with her fan and a feminine suggestion of tender care which thrilled that gentleman. "Well," continued Raymond, "that Robert McCare over yonder came here some 3 or 4 days ago as a tramp, in want of everything but honest labor. Our lamented friend consented to parley with him, which was something remarkable in the doctor. Still more remarkable, he gave him a suit of clothes, and, it is said, some money, and sent him on his way. Now, more remarkable than all, our friend, on hearing of his benefactor's death, actually tramps back here to attend his funeral. The doctor being dead, his executors not of a kind to emulate the doctor's spasmodic generosity, and there being no chance of future favors, the act must be recorded as purely and simply gratitude. By Jove! I don't know but that he is the only one here who can be called a real mourner. I'm here because your sister is here, Carol comes because you do, and you come because your mother cannot. And who tells you these pretty stories? Asked Maruja, with her face still turned towards Carol. The foreman, Harrison, who, with an extensive practical experience of tramps, was struck with this exception to the general rule. Poor man, one ought to do something for him, said Amitat, compassionately. What, said Raymond, with affected terror, and spoil this perfect story? Never. If I should offer him $10, I'd expect him to kick me, if he took it, I'd expect to kick him. He is not so bad looking, is he, Maruja? Asked Amita of her sister. But Maruja had already moved a few paces off with Carol, and seemed to be listening to him only. Raymond smiled at the pretty perplexity of Amita's eyebrows over this pronounced indiscretion. Don't mind them, he whispered, you really cannot expect to duenna your elder sister. Tell me, would you actually like me to see if I could assist the virtuous tramp? You have only to speak. But Amita's interest appeared to be so completely appeased with Raymond's simple offer that she only smiled, blushed, and said no. Maruja's quick ears had taken in every word of these asides, and for an instant she hated her sister for her aimless declination of Raymond's proposal. But becoming conscious under her eyelids that the stranger was moving away with the dispersing crowd, she rejoined Amita with her usual manner. The others had re-entered the carriage, but Maruja took it into her head to proceed on foot to the rude building whence the mourners had issued. The foreman, Harrison, flushed and startled by this apparition of inaccessible beauty at his threshold, came eagerly forward. I shall not trouble you now, Mr. Harrison, she said, with a polite exaggeration of the consonants, but some day I shall ride over here, and ask you to show me your wonderful machines. She smiled, and turned back to seek her carriage. But before she had gone many yards she found that she had completely lost it in the intervening billows of grain. She stopped, with an impatient little Spanish ejaculation. The next moment the stalks of wheat parted before her and a figure emerged. It was the stranger. She fell back a step in utter helplessness. He, on his side, retreated again into the wheat, holding it back with extended arms to let her pass. As she moved forward mechanically, without a word he moved backward, making a path for her until she was able to discern the coachman's whip above the bending heads of the grain just beyond her. He stopped here and drew to one side, his arms still extended, to give her free passage. She tried to speak, but could only bow her head, and slipped by him with a strange feeling suggested by his attitude that she was evading his embrace. But the next moment his arms were lowered, the grain closed around him, and he was lost to her view. She reached the carriage almost unperceived by the inmates, and pounced upon her sister with a laugh. Blessed Virgin, said Amita, where did you come from? From there, said Maruja, with a slight nervous shiver, pointing to the clustering grain. We were afraid you were lost. So was I, said Maruja, raising her pretty lashes heavenwards, as she drew a shawl tightly round her shoulders. Has anything happened? You look strange, said Carol, drawing closer to her. Her eyes were sparkling, but she was very pale. Nothing, nothing, she said, hastily, glancing at the grain again. If it were not that the haste would have been absolutely indecent, I should say that the late doctor had made you a ghostly visit, said Raymond, looking at her curiously. He would have been polite enough not to have commented on my looks, said Maruja. Am I really such a fright? Carol thought he had never seen her so beautiful. Her eyelids were quivering over their fires as if they had been brushed by the passing wing of a strong passion. What are you thinking of? Said Carol, as they drove on. She was thinking that the stranger had looked at her admiringly, and that his eyes were blue. But she looked quietly into her lover's face, and said, sweetly, nothing, I fear, that would interest you. Chapter 9. The news of the assignment of Dr. West's property to Mrs. Saltonstall was followed by the still more astonishing discovery that the doctor's will further bequeathed to her his entire property, after payment of his debts and liabilities. It was given in recognition of her talents and business integrity during their late association, and as an evidence of the confidence and undying affection of the testator. Nevertheless, after the first surprise, the fact was accepted by the community as both natural and proper under that singular instinct of humanity which acquiesces without scruple in the union of two large fortunes, but sharply questions the conjunction of poverty and affluence, and looks only for interested motives where there is disparity of wealth. Had Mrs. Saltonstall been a poor widow instead of a rich one, had she been the doctor's housekeeper instead of his business friend, the bequest would have been strongly criticized if not legally tested. But this combination, which placed the entire Valley of San Antonio in the control of a single individual, appeared to be perfectly legitimate. More than that, some vague rumor of the doctor's past and his early entanglements only seemed to make this eminently practical disposition of his property the more respectable, and condoned for any moral irregularities of his youth. The effect upon the collateral branches of the Gutierrez family and the servants and retainers was even more impressive. For once, it seemed that the fortunes and traditions of the family were changed. The female Gutierrez, instead of impoverishing the property, had augmented it, the foreigner and intruder had been despoiled, the fate of La Misión Perdida had been changed, the curse of Corotera had proved a blessing, his prophet and descendant, Perillo, the mayordomo, moved in an atmosphere of superstitious adulation and respect among the domestics and common people. This recognition of his power he received at times with a certain exaltation of grandiloquent pride beyond the conception of any but a Spanish servant, and at times with a certain dull, pained vacancy of perception and an expression of frightened bewilderment which also went far to establish his reputation as an unconscious seer and thaumaturgist. "Thou seest," said Sanchez to the partly skeptical Faquita, "he does not know more than an infant what is his power. That is the proof of it." The Dona Maria alone did not participate in this appreciation of Perillo, and when it was proposed that a feast or celebration of rejoicing should be given under the old pear tree by the Indians' mound, her indignation was long remembered by those that witnessed it. "It is not enough that we have been made ridiculous in the past," she said to Maruja, "by the interference of this solemn fool, but that the memory of our friend is to be insulted by his generosity being made into a triumph of Perillo's idiotic ancestor. One would have thought those coyotes and Corotera's bones had been buried with the cruel gossip of your relations." It had been the recent habit of Dona Maria to allude to the family as being particularly related to Maruja alone, over my poor friend. "Let him beware that his ancestor's mound is not uprooted with the pear tree, and his heathenish temple destroyed. If, as the engineer says, a branch of the new railroad can be established for La Misión Perdida, I agree with him that it can better pass at that point with less sacrifice to the domain. It is the one uncultivated part of the park, and lies at the proper angle. You surely would not consent to this, my mother," said Maruja, with a sudden impression of a newly found force in her mother's character. "Why not, child?" said the relict of Mr. Saltonstall and the mourner of Dr. West, coldly. "I admit it was discreet of thee in old times to have thy sentimental passages there with caballeros who, like the guests of the Hidalgo that kept a skeleton at his feast, were reminded of the mutability of their hopes by Corotera's bones and the legend. But with the explosion of this idea of a primal curse, like Eve's, on the property," added the Dona Maria, with a slight bitterness, "thou mayest have thy seat as elsewhere. Thou canst scarcely keep this Captain Carroll any longer at a distance by rattling those bones of Corotera in his face. And of a truth, child, since the affair of the letters, and his discreet and honorable conduct since, I see not why thou shouldst. He has thy mother's reputation in his hands. He is a gentleman, my mother," said Maruja, quietly. "And they are scarce, child, and should be rewarded and preserved. That is what I meant, silly one. This captain is not rich, but then, thou hast enough for both." "But it was Umita that first brought him here," said Maruja, looking down with an air of embarrassed thoughtfulness, which Dona Maria chose to instantly accept as exaggerated coyness. Do not think to deceive me or thyself, child, with this folly. Thou art old enough to know a man's mind, if not thine own. Besides, I do not know that I shall object to her liking for Raymond. He is very clever, and would be a relief to some of thy relatives. He would be invaluable to us in the emergencies that may grow out of these mechanical affairs that I do not understand, such as the mill and the railroad. And you propose to take a few husbands as partners in the business, said Maruja, who had recovered her spirits. I warn you that Captain Carroll is as stupid as a gentleman could be. I wonder that he has not blundered in other things as badly as he has in preferring me to Amita. He confided to me only last night that he had picked up a pocketbook belonging to the doctor and given it to Aladdin, without a witness or receipt, and evidently of his own accord. A pocketbook of the doctor's, repeated Dona Maria. Aye, but it contained nothing of thine, said Maruja. The poor child had sense enough to think of that. But I am in no hurry to ask your consent and your blessing yet, little mother. I could even bear that Amita should precede me to the altar, if the exigencies of thy business require it. It might also secure Captain Carroll for me. Nay, look not at me in that cheapening, commercial way with compound interest in thine eyes. I am not so poor an investment, truly, of thy original capital. Thou art thy father's child, said her mother, suddenly kissing her, and that is saying enough, the Blessed Virgin knows. Go now, she continued, gently pushing her from the room, and send Amita hither. She watched the disappearance of Maruja's slightly rebellious shoulders, and added to herself, and this is the child that Amita really believes is pining with lovesickness for Carol, so that she can neither sleep nor eat. This is the girl that Faquita would have me think hath no longer any heart in her dress or in her finery. Soul of Joseph Saltonstall, ejaculated the widow, lifting her shoulders and her eyes together, thou hast much to account for. 2 weeks later she again astonished her daughter. Why dost thou not join the party that drives over to see the wonders of Aladdin's palace today? It would seem more proper that thou shouldst accompany thy guests than Raymond and Amita. I have never entered his doors since the day he was disrespectful to my mother's daughter, said Maruja, in surprise. Disrespectful, repeated Dona Maria, impatiently. Thy father's daughter ought to know that such as he may be ignorant and vulgar, but cannot be disrespectful to her. And there are offenses, child, it is much more crushing to forget than to remember. As long as he has not the presumption to apologize, I see no reason why thou mayst not go. He has not been here since that affair of the letters. I shall not permit him to be uncivil over that, dost thou understand? He is of use to me in business. Thou mayst take Carol with thee, he will understand that. But Carol will not go, said Maruja. He will not say what passed between them, but I suspect they quarreled. All the better, then, that thou goest alone. He need not be reminded of it. Fear not but that he will be only too proud of thy visit to think of aught else. Maruja, who seemed relieved at this prospect of being unaccompanied by Captain Carroll, shrugged her shoulders and assented. When the party that afternoon drove into the courtyard of Aladdin's palace, the announcement that its hospitable proprietor was absent, and would not return until dinner, did not abate either their pleasure or their curiosity. As already intimated to the reader, Mr. Prince's functions as host were characteristically irregular, and the servant's suggestion, that Mr. Prince's private secretary would attend to do the honors, created little interest, and was laughingly waived by Maruja. There really is not the slightest necessity to trouble the gentleman, she said, politely. I know the house thoroughly, and I think I have shown it once or twice before for your master. Indeed, she added, turning to her party, I have been already complimented on my skill as a cicerone. After a pause, she continued, with a slight exaggeration of action and in her deepest contralto, ahem, ladies and gentlemen, the ball and court in which we are now standing is a perfect copy of the court of lions at the Alhambra, and was finished in 14 days in white pine, gold, and plaster, at a cost of $10,000. A photograph of the original structure hangs on the wall. You will observe, ladies and gentlemen, that the reproduction is perfect. The Alhambra is in Granada, a province of Spain, which it is said in some respects to resemble California, where you have probably observed the Spanish language is still spoken by the old settlers. We now cross the stable yard on a bridge which is a facsimile in appearance and dimensions of the bridge of size at Venice, connecting the Doge's palace with the state prison. Here, on the contrary, instead of being ushered into a dreary dungeon, as in the great original, a fresh surprise awaits us. Allow me, ladies and gentlemen, to precede you for the surprise. We open a door thus and presto. She stopped, speechless, on the threshold, the fan fell from her gesticulating hand. In the center of a brilliantly lit conservatory, with golden columns, a young man was standing. As her fan dropped on the tessellated pavement, he came forward, picked it up, and put it in her rigid and mechanical fingers. The party, who had applauded her apparently artistic climax, laughingly pushed by her into the conservatory, without noticing her agitation. It was the same face and figure she remembered as last standing before her, holding back the crowding grain in the San Antonio field. But here he was apparelled and appointed like a gentleman, and even seemed to be superior to the garish glitter of his new surroundings. "I believe I have the pleasure of speaking to Miss Saltonstall," he said, with the faintest suggestion of his former manner in his half-resentful sidelong glance. "I hear that you offered to dispense with my services, but I knew that Mr. Prince would scarcely be satisfied if I did not urge it once more upon you in person. I am his private secretary." At the same moment, Amita and Raymond, attracted by the conversation, turned towards him. Their recognition of the man they had seen at Dr. West's was equally distinct. The silence became embarrassing. Two pretty girls of the party pressed to Amita's side, with half-audible whispers. "What is it? Who's your handsome and wicked-looking friend? Is this the surprise?" At the sound of their voices, Maruja recovered herself coldly. "Ladies," she said, with a slight wave of her fan, "this is Mr. Prince's private secretary. I believe it is hardly fair to take up his valuable time. Allow me to thank you, sir, for picking up my fan." With a single subtle flash of the eye she swept by him, taking her companions to the other end of the conservatory. When she turned, he was gone. "This was certainly an unexpected climax," said Raymond, mischievously. "Did you really arrange it beforehand? We leave a picturesque tramp at the edge of a grave, we pass over 6 weeks and a bridge of size, and hey, presto! We find a private secretary in a conservatory. This is quite the regular Aladdin business." "You may laugh," said Maruja, who had recovered her spirits, "but if you were really clever you'd find out what it all means. Don't you see that Amita is dying of curiosity? Let us fly at once and discover the secret, then," said Raymond, slipping Amita's arm through his. "We will consult the oracle in the stables. Come." The others followed, leaving Maruja for an instant alone. She was about to rejoin them when she heard footsteps in the passage they had just crossed, and then perceived that the young stranger had merely withdrawn to allow the party to precede him before he returned to the other building through the conservatory, which he was just entering. In turning quickly to escape, the black lace of her overskirt caught in the spines of a snaky-looking cactus. She stopped to disengage herself with feverish haste in vain. She was about to sacrifice the delicate material, in her impatience, when the young man stepped quietly to her side. "Allow me. Perhaps I have more patience, even if I have less time," he said, stooping down. Their ungloved hands touched. Maruja stopped in her efforts and stood up. He continued until he had freed the luckless flounce, conscious of the soft fire of her eyes on his head and neck. "There," he said, rising and encountering her glance. As she did not speak, he continued, "You are thinking, Miss Saltonstall, that you have seen me before, are you not? Well, you have, I asked you the road to San Jose one morning when I was tramping by your hedge. And as you probably were looking for something better which you seem to have found, you didn't care to listen to my directions, said Maruja, quickly. I found a man, almost the only one who ever offered me a gratuitous kindness, at whose grave I afterwards met you. I found another man who befriended me here, where I meet you again. She was beginning to be hysterically nervous lest anyone should return and find them together. She was conscious of a tingling of vague shame. Yet she lingered. The strange fascination of his half-savage melancholy, and a reproachfulness that seemed to arraign her, with the rest of the world, at the bar of his vague resentment, held the delicate fibers of her sensitive being as cruelly and relentlessly as the thorns of the cactus had gripped her silken lace. Without knowing what she was saying, she stammered that she was glad he connected her with his better fortune, and began to move away. He noticed it with his sidelong lids, and added, with a slight bitterness, "I don't think I should have intruded here again, but I thought you had gone. But I am afraid you have not seen the last of me. It was the intention of my employer, Mr. Prince, to introduce me to you and your mother. I suppose he considers it part of my duties here. I must warn you that, if you are here when he returns, he will insist upon it, and upon your meeting me with these ladies at dinner." "Perhaps so, he is my mother's friend," said Maruja, "but you have the advantage of us, you can always take to the road, you know." The smile with which she had intended to accompany the speech did not come as readily in execution as it had in conception, and she would have given worlds to have recalled her words. But he said, "That's so," quietly, and turned away, as if to give her an opportunity to escape. She moved hesitatingly towards the passage and stopped. The sound of the returning voices gave her a sudden courage. "Mr. Guest," said the young man, "if we do conclude to stay to dinner, as Mr. Prince has said nothing of introducing you to my sister, you must let me have that pleasure." He lifted his eyes to hers with a sudden flush. But she had fled. She reached her party, displaying her torn flounce as the cause of her delay, and there was a slight quickness in her breathing and her speech which was attributed to the same grave reason. "But, only listen," said Amita, "we've got it all out of the butler and the grooms. It's such a romantic story." "What is?" said Maruja, suddenly. "Why, the private tramps." "The peripatetic secretary," suggested Raymond. "Yes," continued Amita, "Mr. Prince was so struck with his gratitude to the old doctor that he hunted him up in San Jose, and brought him here. Since then Prince has been so interested in him, it appears he was somebody in the States, or has rich relations, that he has been telegraphing and making all sorts of inquiries about him, and has even sent out his own lawyer to hunt up everything about him. Are you listening?"
"Yes."
"You seem abstracted."
"I am hungry."
"Why not dine here? It's an hour earlier than at home. Aladdin would fall at your feet for the honor."
"Do."
Maruja looked at them with innocent vagueness, as if the possibility were just beginning to dawn upon her. "And Clara Wilson is just dying to see the mysterious unknown again.
Say yes, little Maruja."
Little Maruja glanced at them with a large maternal compassion.
"We shall see."
Mr. Prince, on his return an hour later, was unexpectedly delighted with Maruja's gracious acceptance of his invitation to dinner. He was thoroughly sensible of the significance which his neighbors had attached to the avoidance by the salt and stall heiress of his various parties and gorgeous festivities ever since a certain act of indiscretion now alleged to have been produced by the exaltation of wine had placed him under ban. Whatever his feelings were towards her mother, he could not fail to appreciate fully this act of the daughter, which rehabilitated him. It was with more than his usual extravagance shown, even in a certain exaggeration of respect towards Maruja, that he welcomed the party, and made preparations for the dinner. The telegraph and mounted messengers were put into rapid requisition. The bridal suite was placed at the disposal of the young ladies for a dressing room. The attendant genii surpassed themselves. The evening dresses of Maruja, Amita, and the Mrs. Wilson, summoned by electricity from La Mission Perdida, and dispatched by the fleetest conveyances, were placed in the arms of their maids,
smothered with bouquets, an hour before dinner. An operatic concert troupe, passing through the nearest town, were diverted from their course by the slaves of the ring to discourse hidden music in the music room during dinner. "Bite my finger, sweet lips," said Miss Clara Wilson, who had a neat taste for apt quotation, to Maruja, "that I may see if I am awake. It's the Arabian Nights all over again." The dinner was a marvel, even in a land of gastronomic marvels, the dessert a miracle of fruits, even in a climate that bore the products of two zones. Maruja, from her seat beside her satisfied host, looked across a bank of yellow roses at her sister and Raymond, and was timidly conscious of the eyes of young guest, who was seated at the other end of the table, between the two Misses Wilson. With a strange haunting of his appearance on the day she first met him, she stole glances of half-frightened curiosity at him while he was eating, and was relieved to find that he used his knife and fork like the others, and that his appetite was far from voracious. It was his employer who was the first to recall the experiences of his past life, with a certain enthusiasm and the air of a host anxious to contribute to the entertainment of his guests. "You'd hardly believe, Miss Saltonstall, that young gentleman over there walked across the continent and 2,000-odd miles, wasn't it, all alone, and with not much more in the way of traps than he's got on now. Tell him, Harry, how the Apaches nearly gobbled you up, and then let you go because they thought you as good an Injun as any one of them, and how you lived a week in the desert on two biscuits as big as that." A chorus of entreaty and delighted anticipation followed the suggestion. The old expression of being at bay returned for an instant to guest's face, but, lifting his eyes, he caught a look of almost sympathetic anxiety from Maruja's, who had not spoken. "It became necessary for me, some time ago," said guest, half explanatorily, to Maruja, "to be rather explicit in the details of my journey here, and I told Mr. Prince some things which he seems to think interesting to others. That is all. To save my life on one occasion, I was obliged to show myself as good as an Indian, in his own way, and I lived among them and traveled with them for 2 weeks. I have been hungry, as I suppose others have on like occasions, but nothing more." Nevertheless, in spite of his evident reticence, he was obliged to give way to their entreaties, and, with a certain grim and uncompromising truthfulness of statement, recounted some episodes of his journey. It was none the less thrilling that he did it reluctantly, and in much the same manner as he had answered his father's questions, and as he had probably responded to the later cross-examination of Mr. Prince. He did not tell it emotionally, but rather with the dogged air of one who had been subjected to a personal grievance for which he neither asked nor expected sympathy. When he did not raise his eyes to Maruja's, he kept them fixed on his plate. "Well," said Prince, when a long-drawn sigh of suspended emotion among the guests testified to his powers as a caterer to their amusement, "what do you say to some music with our coffee to follow the story?"
"It's more like a play," said Amita to Raymond.
"What a pity Captain Carroll, who knows all about Indians, isn't here to have enjoyed it. But I suppose Maruja, who hasn't lost a word, will tell it to him."
"I don't think she will," said Raymond, dryly, glancing at Maruja, who, lost in some intricate pattern of her Chinese plate, was apparently unconscious that her host was waiting her signal to withdraw. At last she raised her head, and said, gently but audibly, to the waiting prince, "It is positively a newer pattern, the old one had not that delicate straw line in the arabesque. You must have had it made for you."
"I did," said the gratified prince, taking up the plate.
"What eyes you have, Miss Saltonstall! They see everything."
"Except that I'm keeping you all waiting," she returned, with a smile, letting the eyes in question fall with a half-parting salutation on guest as she rose. It was the first exchange of a common instinct between them, and left them as conscious as if they had pressed hands. The music gave an opportunity for some desultory conversation, in which Mr. Prince and his young friend received an invitation from Maruja to visit La Mission, and the party, by common consent, turned into the conservatory, where the genial host begged them each to select a flower from a few especially rare exotics.
When Maruja received hers, she said, laughingly, to Prince, "Will you think me very importunate if I ask for another?"
"Take what you like, you have only to name it," he replied, gallantly.
"But that's just what I can't do," responded the young girl, "unless," she added, turning to Guest, "unless you can assist me.
It was the plant I was examining today."
"I think I can show it to you," said Guest, with a slight increase of color, as he preceded her towards the memorable cactus near the door, "but I doubt if it has any flower."
Nevertheless, it had a bright red blossom, like a spot of blood drawn by one of its thorns. He plucked it for her, and she placed it in her belt.
"You are forgiving," he said, admiringly.
"You ought to know that," she returned, looking down.
Why?
"You were rude to me twice."
"Twice?"
"Yes, once at the Mission of La Perdita, once in the road at San Antonio." His eyes became downcast and gloomy.
"At the Mission that morning, I, a wretched outcast, only saw in you a beautiful girl intent on overriding me with her merciless beauty. At San Antonio I handed the fan I picked up to the man whose eyes told me he loved you."
She started impatiently.
"You might have been more gallant, and found more difficulty in the selection," she said, pertly.
"But since when have you gentlemen become so observant and so punctilious? Would you expect him to be as considerate of others?"
"I have few claims that anyone seems bound to respect," he returned, brusquely.
Then, in a softer voice, he added, looking at her, gently,
"You were in mourning when you came here this afternoon, Miss Saltonstall."
"Was I?"
"It was for Dr. West, my mother's friend. It was very becoming to you."
"You are complimenting me.
But I warn you that Captain Carroll said something better than that. He said mourning was not necessary for me. I had only to put my eyelashes at half-mast. He is a soldier, you know."
"He seems to be as witty as he is fortunate," said Guest, bitterly.
"Do you think he is fortunate?" said Maruja, raising her eyes to his. There was so much in this apparently simple question that Guest looked in her eyes for a suggestion. What he saw there for an instant made his heart stop beating. She apparently did not know it, for she began to tremble too.
"Is he not?" said Guest, in a low voice.
"Do you think he ought to be?" she found herself whispering. A sudden silence fell upon them. The voices of their companions seemed very far in the distance, the warm breath of the flowers appeared to be drowning their senses, they tried to speak, but could not, they were so near to each other that the two long blades of a palm served to hide them. In the midst of this profound silence a voice that was like and yet unlike Maruja said twice, "Go, go," but each time seemed hushed in the stifling silence. The next moment the palms were pushed aside, the dark figure of a young man slipped like some lithe animal through the shrubbery, and Maruja found herself standing, pale and rigid, in the middle of the walk, in the full glare of the light, and looking down the corridor toward her approaching companions. She was furious and frightened, she was triumphant and trembling, without thought, sense, or reason, she had been kissed by Henry Guest, and had returned it. The fleetest horses of Aladdin's stud that night could not carry her far enough or fast enough to take her away from that moment, that scene, and that sensation. Wise and experienced, confident in her beauty, secure in her selfishness, strong over others' weaknesses, weighing accurately the deeds and words of men and women, recognizing all there was in position and tradition, seeing with her father's clear eyes the practical meaning of any divergence from that conventionality which as a woman of the world she valued, she returned again and again to the trembling joy of that intoxicating moment. She though of her mother and sisters, of Raymond and Garney, of Aladdin she even forced herself to think of Carol only to shut her eyes, with a faint smile, and dream again the brief but thrilling dream of Guest that began and ended in their joined and parted lips. Small wonder that, hidden and silent in her enwrappings, as she lay back in the carriage, with her pale face against the cold starry sky, two other stars came out and glistened and trembled on her passion-fringed lashes.